Good morning, CLC. How you guys doing? For those of you who don't know, my name is Sam. I'm the campus pastor out in Northwest Indiana. I haven't been with you guys for a while. Thank you for that thundering response to that. Yes. You know, it's really cool. I was just telling Pastor Ben, there's so many new faces here, and God is so good, because we've launched two new churches in the last 6 months, 8 months or so, and just to see new people coming in, we just love to see new people join our family here at CLC, so welcome. My name is Sam. We'll get to know each other real well today, and I'm just honored to be able to preach with you today. Pastor Jerry and Pastor Chris are out in the Philippines, minister and empower. Last night, our Philippines campus had their 18th anniversary. It was this morning there, and 50 people received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. It's so awesome. And in addition, they had over 2,000 people at their 18th anniversary. That's at one campus. They have like 30 out there, I feel like. They are exploding. It's so good. So we miss our pastors. Make sure to keep them covered in prayer. Also want to take this opportunity to welcome our online audience. Give each other a big shout out on that sidebar. We can get up for them too. A lot of people on the road this weekend driving. You guys are serious about church, which I love, because you're in church on Memorial Day weekend. Great place to be. So today, I'm going to preach a message to you called the Ox Code. Everybody say Ox Code. And it's from Judges 3:31. If you want to turn there, we're going to get there in just a minute. Judges 3:31. And let me just give you a backstory where this came from. My wife was out of town with our little guy. And if you've been married for a while, you know the feeling like when you try to go to bed and it's kind of lonely. It's like that spot next to you is missing, right? And so I couldn't sleep, and I'm flipping through the channels. It's like 12:30, 1 o'clock at night. And I ran across something by a guy named Pat Williams on TBN. And it was so good that I ordered three of his books on the spot. I just took my cell phone and ordered from Amazon. And one of those books was called Success Secrets of Shamgar. And so I'm going to borrow a lot of opportunity. I want to give credit where that's due. I highly recommend that book. It's Success Secrets of Shamgar by Pat Williams and Jay Strack. It's a great read. So I'm going to take that. I'm going to give him credit one time. And now I'm going to use the rest for myself and not give him credit again. So just giving you a heads up there. But a lot of information from here, along with some personal revelation that I feel like I've gotten through it. So I'm going to pray and then preach. Is that cool? All right, let's pray. Father, I pray that you be with our pastors, keep them safe as they're gone. And Father, I pray that we say yes to your best for our life. In Jesus' name, amen. So Taylor, our little guy named Daniel, and myself went on our first family vacation a couple weeks ago, and this is a complete side note. Somebody here was so generous that they gave us a timeshare to use free of charge for the entire week. So if you have any use it or lose it points, anything like that with timeshares, my email address is Sam. at clc.tv. I got one whole week of vacation left, and I'm going to pray in that blessing today. So anyways, speaking of that, I'm a Dutchman by heritage, and I get teased about this from time to time, if you can't tell with the blonde hair, blue eyes, and all this stuff. But one thing Dutch people are known for is kind of being a little bit frugal. It's a nice way to put a little bit cheap, right? If you go out with a Dutch person, they'll all be like, let's go Dutch. You guys heard that saying? We're going to split this right down the middle. So we get teased from time to time. So when we pulled up to our timeshare, the lady checked us in really nice, was like, hey, on Tuesday, we got some slots open. Why don't you come and hear a presentation? And after that, what we're going to do for you is give you free show tickets and dinner. And if you guys ever, anybody ever gone to listen to a timeshare presentation? Yeah. And so we're down there, and of course we go not once, but twice, because why wouldn't we, right? And so this lady gives us a timeshare presentation. We go check in, and you guys, you know, if you've been there, let me explain kind of how it's late. They explain to you that if you ever want to take a vacation again, you have to get a timeshare. If you don't, you're never going to go on another getaway ever again. And so at the end, it kind of comes time for the big reveal, I call it. And so they come in, and the lady goes and talks to this secret person in the back room, and she comes back and says, oh my goodness, I've never seen an offer this great. I can't believe we're getting you in at this price. And so I'm like, okay, you know, I'm getting excited. I'm like thinking, let's go. So they slide the secret piece of paper up, right? And I flip it over. And check this out. For only $22,000 at 17, and a half percent interest, that were going to let me take another vacation. And it's like, thank you. And so, you guys are so generous, you know? And so, Say, here, you know, that's a great offer. Let me give you my counter offer. You know, that's your offer. Let me give you my best. So I said, and this isn't for everybody, I'm just letting you know. But my wife and I, we took a vow at the beginning of this year, and I'm telling the lady this, that we're never going to take out another loan again. Thank you. And how many, you guys know, like when you try to do something like that, like all of a sudden it's like, oh my gosh, I want to buy everything, you know? And so we just said, we just feel like for us, it's the best way that we, if there's a blessing, we can meet it long term. Yeah. And so we just said, hey, we made a vow, and I'm telling the ladies, we made a vow to never take out another debt again. We believe that it's the best way we can live on this earth. And so let me give you my counter offer. You're not going to like this, but I'm going to put $1,000 on the table. And in return, I expect a deed in full. That's my counter offer. And she kind of looks at me like I'm crazy. But, you know, Pastor Jerry said it before, if you got favor, what's the point if you don't use it, right? Might as well try. And so the lady, all of a sudden the conversation kind of takes like a little bit of a shift. The first thing out of this lady's mouth is, are you one of those followers of Dave Ramsey? And I was like, and then all of a sudden starts to paint like this awful scenario that if we never have debt, then we'll never have credit, then we'll never have a home, then we'll never have a car. And in her mind, she's trying to justify that if we don't buy this timeshare right now, if we don't do this, then this will never happen. And I was kind of like, wow. And she's like going in on it like, hey, listen, this is the principle and the foundation of what this country is found on. My response was, how's that going for this country? Right? You know, we're like $800 trillion in debt with no sign at the end. But something clicked in my head that all so often people start living in the way things are rather than the way they could be. Yes. And somebody here needs to understand this today, that you don't have to live the way you're living. That you don't have to live broke. That you don't have to live letting your kids do whatever they want, whenever they want. That your life can be turned around just like this. That things don't have to be that the way they are right now. Oh, this is going to be fun today. So here's the thing. I think all so often when we start talking this way about what could be, all so often the devil tries to come in and paint this picture that if we do this, then the worst case scenario will happen. That if you step out in faith, then what happens if it doesn't happen again? But what I'm learning in my faith walk is that we should never respond to what the world says. We should always respond to what the Word says. You know, so often you hear, if you do this, then this is going to happen. But my word of God says, if I stand on His truth, He will set you free. You know, so often you might have got a bad report from the doctor and they say it's terminal. And I'm not saying anything bad against doctors, but my doctor says, if you lay hands on the sick, they shall be healed. You know, so often, church, we hear all these things like, if you give, you're not going to have any money in return. But God says, if you give all, then I'll unleash the storehouse upon you. Your then should always be defined by the Word and not the world.
Yeah. Yes. That's good. Yes.
That's good. And this is kind of like my big idea today, and it's like the biggest if and then there is. And there are some Bible characters that really understood this. One was David when he went and fought Goliath. One was Paul when he just stands in. Some are disciples. They all understood this principle, Noah and the Ark. And if we can get this today, man, we're going to walk out of here and change the world. And so here it is, and it's going to be really simple. You're like, that's it, but this is it. If you do what you can do, God will do what only He can do. Thank you, one person in the back that's excited. If you do what you can do, then God will do what only He can do. And so what I want to do in the next couple minutes is look at a guy named Shamgar. Everybody say Shamgar.
Shamgar.
This was a guy who stood on this word and did what only he could do. And God came back and did what only he could do. And we're going to read this story. If you never heard it before, I just ran into this. This is going to change your life. Just to give you a little background, we're going to go to Judges 3:31. If you guys want to turn there, YouVersion, Bible app, Bible.com, any of that stuff, we're cool with all that here. And if you don't have any of that stuff, we'll get it on the screen. Judges 3:31. Just give you a little background. So we're all on the same page. The book of Judges was written in a time frame where Moses was long gone. Joshua led the people into the promised land. And now we're in a period of Judges where it's really not a good place for the Israelites. They had really gotten into some evil stuff again. Judges 2 and 10 says that now a whole generation of people have been raised up that knew nothing about the good things the Lord has done. Now, I want to pause right there and say, parents, that is the uttermost importance, and grandparents, of speaking and standing on what God has done for you in your life.
Yeah.
Because if we don't, we'll wind up in this situation. And so here we have a whole group of people who have never heard of the great things God has done. And here in this place, all these people are doing some really evil things, serving Baal, you name it, they're doing it. And here we come find Shamgar, and we read only about him two times in the entire Bible. The first one is Judges 5, 6, and 7, kind of paints this picture of how bad it is. And it says, in the days of Shamgar and in the days of Jael, people avoided the main roads, and travelers stayed on winding pathways. And this verse is just kind of laying out that times were so bad, and we can relate to this in the city of Chicago, that like, let's say a straight line is like this, times are so bad that we're going to go all the way around because we don't want to get beat up on the way. You know, sometimes in the city, I'll punch in a GPS and it's like, you're going to take me through that neighborhood. I'm not going that way. I'm going around. You know, like anybody ever been there? You know, times are like pretty bad in this time. And here comes Shamgar, Judges 3:31 in the NIV. After Ehud came Shamgar, son of Anath, who struck down 600 Philistines with an ox goad. He too saved Israel. I'm going to read that one more time. After Ehud came Shamgar, who struck down 600 Philistines with an ox goad. He too saved Israel. You know, sometimes we read something and we don't understand the significance of it. And so I read this like a couple times and it's like just buzzed right on past. But one day I'm like, what in the world is an ox goad? Okay? So back in the day, some of you guys know this, you would plow and behind you would have to stand behind the plow. And to keep the oxen going straight forward, you had a big long stick, 5 to 10 feet with a spear on the end. That was an ox goad. So you had this 10-foot stick with a little spear and you poke the oxen to make sure that they keep going in the direction. So here we have Shamgar. Don't miss this. Killed 600 people with a stick. Right? And so if he's got one of these ox goad tools, chances are that we can kind of deduct through reasoning that he was a farmer. And so what I love about God is this, is that God chose somebody who's uneducated, probably never studied the art of war, and had zero training on how to go out. And God choosing an uneducated farmer to go stand against 600 people. And in this, we get a great truth of Scripture. You guys ready for this? That with God, anything, at any time, at any place, at any point is possible. That you might have walked in here today and your situation is so jacked up, you don't even have two nickels to rub together. God can snap his fingers and turn it around. With God, all things are possible. Now, you still might not believe it, but look at the story of Shamgar. How else could somebody do what they can do so God can only do what he can do? You see, if you move out of this seat and do what God has called you to do, man, there's no telling what God can do through you. Man, I'm excited today. So I'm going to give you in the next couple minutes, look at the life of Shamgar and kind of pull out three success secrets we find in his life. Three things that he does that if we apply, man, they're going to put us on the next level. And before we do that, I kind of want to just make sure we're all on the same page. So I'm going to define success really quick. There's so many different levels of success. We're talking a little bit about success today. One is from a guy named Zig Ziglar, leadership guru. Mr. Ziglar says, if you want your dreams to come true, you must be willing to help other people's dreams come true. It's a really good definition. John Maxwell, leadership guru as well. He says, success is when those who know you the best love you the most. Now, some of you guys know, unfortunately, it's not like that with everybody. You get to know somebody, it's like, wow, I don't like you. That's a good definition, though, too. The one that I want to work with today is this. Success simply means saying yes to God's best for your life. Amen. Success is simply saying yes to God's best for your life. True success, and you guys know this, has nothing to do with title, fame, or money. It has everything to do with taking what you got and using it for God's most glory right where you're positioned right now. And if you do that, you'll always be a success in God's face. And here's the thing where a lot of us go wrong. Success is not trying to go out and imitate somebody else's success. So if I go out into downtown Chicago in some neighborhood that I might not be in, shouldn't be in, and I take out an ox goad and I stand on the corner and say, oh, come at me, gangster disciples, I'm going to get you. chances are it's not going to go too well for me. Because an ox goad is not my call, it's Shamgar's call. You know? Common sense prevails a lot of the time. And so you need to do what only God has called you to do. Quit trying to be like so-and-so at your job. Quit trying to be like so-and-so's dad. Quit trying to be like your classmate and student. Success is saying God's best to your best, not somebody else's. So let's give you three quick success secrets, and then we'll get out of here. We're going to pray. God's going to move. It's going to be awesome. Success secret number one, start where you are. Start where you are. Shamgar started right where he was at on a farm in Palestine. No education, no training, simply a farmer. He started right where he was at, not where he wished he was. And wherever here is for you right now is where you have to start. And, you know, you might find yourself coming in here in a place of debt. The best thing you can do is say, I'm starting right here. Stare that debt in the face and say, this is where I'm starting from. The best thing you can do is start right here, no matter what the situation. God might have caught you. You might think like, man, I never thought I would be here. I was thinking like during the service today, I never thought I would have started off back there and be preaching. God's got a really sense of humor. I walked in the doors just attending church here. But nothing like catches God by surprise. Like you might be doing somersaults up here next year. Like nothing catches God by surprise. And so here's the thing. These are two big excuses that I hear all the time when it comes to starting where you are. This is in your notes. The when I get more time excuse. Wow. When I get more time. Let me break this down for you, is that we all have one thing in common here, is that there's 24 hours in a day. Come on. It's not how much we have, it's what we do with the time we've been given. And the older I'm getting, the more I realize I have no idea why in the world I think I'll have more time later to do what I should be doing right now. Because the older we get, the more responsibility comes, the more there's bills, there's more things that we can't be doing that we could have been doing before. We need to learn to live in this place called the sacred now, where we understand that this moment right here will never happen again. It's a once-in-a-lifetime moment for you. And so here's the thing, just to help you kind of understand, there's a guy who was starting to understand this whole time thing. So he took out a calculator, he's 55 years old, and he looked on Google, said, what's the average lifespan in America? It was like 75. So he takes a calculator, he puts in 75 times 52 weeks in a year, and out comes in the calculator, 3,900, right? And so what he was doing was he was saying, wow, I have 3,900 Saturdays to pretty much do what I want to do. Interesting, right? And now I know a lot of you are thinking, I don't have Saturdays to do what I want to do. But think about it. Like, you make a choice on a lot of those days when your boss isn't telling you to be somewhere, what you choose to do. And so here's the thing. He says, wow, I'm 55 years old. So he subtracts, and he finds out that he's already lost 2,800 of his Saturdays. So he goes out to the store, buys a clear marble jar and a bunch of marbles, and he puts in 1,100 marbles into this clear jar that represent how many Saturdays if he lives to 75 that he has left. And every single Saturday that passes by, he takes a jar around, throws it in the garbage can, is a visual sign that time is passing away. This is a man who understands living in the sacred now. I would suggest some of us go home and do that to understand that time is ticking even when you don't think it is. Psalm 90 and 12 says this, so teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Teach us to number our days so we gain wisdom. Here's the thing, when it comes to time, you don't find it, you have to make time. Like if you don't schedule time, your schedule is going to schedule you. I've been learning this from Pastor Ben. I look up to him greatly. He coaches us all the time. And he said the Holy Spirit really convicted him this week, or a couple weeks ago, where he was waking up and the first thing he was doing was checking his cell phone for mail, Facebook, all this stuff. Anybody ever been there? And he said, so I changed my routine and the first thing that I do is spend time with the Lord. Here, and like when he said that, it was like a knife through my heart. I was like, wow, the first thing that I do like every single day is like roll over and check my email. And, you know, the thing is, what I'm figuring out is I'm not that important. You know, like, either are you. You know, like, people can wait. And what I've been realizing is when you start your day off with God, your schedule prioritizes itself. Man, schedule your daily devotional time. I'm a big morning guy. I think it sets you up for the rest of the day. And if somebody calls you and says, hey, can you meet me now? And it's during your devotional time. No, I got an appointment with the most important person in the face of this earth. You know, Pastor Jerry was talking about this. He said, what's the best way to write a book? I said, I don't know, you know, and I thought it was a joke or something. And he says, if you write one paragraph a day for 5 days a week, 30 minutes a day, guess what? At the end of the year, you're going to have a pretty good start of a book. You know, the best way to do it is to schedule it so it happens. I encourage you guys, if you have a dream, talk to your husband and wife about it and schedule it with them. And if you have a supportive spouse, you know, they're going to say, okay, take that 30 minutes a day and go do it and have fun. Cool? Here's the second excuse, and this is pretty fun, that I hear all the time, is I'm too old to be what I could have been. I'm too old to be what I could have been. And here's the thing, is that attitude, more than age, determines what we can accomplish in life. Attitude more than age determines what we can accomplish in life. Check out some fun stats here. Ronald Reagan was 69 years old when he was elected president. He was 77 when he finished his last day as president. Architect Frank Lloyd Wright was 89 years old when he finished the Guggenheim Museum. Michelangelo was 68 when he finished the Sistine Chapel. Ben Franklin was 78 when he invented bifocals. But check this out on the flip side for all you young people out there. At age 23, Ben Franklin owned and operated his own newspaper. At the age of 25, he founded a library. And at the age of 37, he invited the first heat event efficient stove. So don't like come out and say, I'm too young or too old, because you're just the right age to seize the opportunity of this very moment. You know, I always get a big kick when young people come out and say, hey, they won't take me seriously because of my age. And like, and I'm not trying to be rude or anything. It's kind of funny, but like, I just like kind of look them up and down. It's like, you know, they're not taking you seriously. It has nothing to do with your age. It's because of the way you're wearing your pants. Like, you know? I mean, like, if you want respect, dress in a way that demands respect. You know, comb your hair, put on some nice shoes. Has nothing to do with your age. We need to learn to live in the sacred now. And one key to doing this, church, is forgetting our past losses. One of the greatest, wisest men of all time named Solomon, a Jewish tradition states that he took a ring and brought it to an engraver and said, engrave on this ring something that holds true in any season of life. And so he gets the ring back, and on it, it simply says, this too shall pass. And Solomon's kind of like, why? I don't get this. But he put the ring on anyways. And he goes out the next day and has a really bad day. And all of a sudden, he looks down at his ring, and he reads, this too shall pass. And then the next day, he comes back, and he has a great day. And he looks at his ring, this too shall pass. You know, some of you guys might have walked in here really jacked up today. This too shall pass. Some of you might have walked in here with the world against you. This too shall pass. And some of you might have walked up here and here. Don't forget to enjoy it, because this too shall pass. Pat Williams, general manager of Philadelphia 76ers, 1982 and 1983, tells a great story. They won the NBA championship. And when you win the NBA championship, you get a ring like this big, right? You guys have seen them. They're huge. And so he said he found himself a year or two down the road. He'd be on the phone talking to clients and stuff. And all of a sudden, the sun would catch his ring. And it would just glare in his face. And he was like, man, I just remember how great that year was. But all of a sudden, he paused and said, I've been reflecting on the past so much in my wins there that I forgot to plan and dream for the future. And for some of you here today, God has done some great things. God has moved in a powerful way. But I stand on the truth of God today that the best is still to come. That if your rearview mirror is bigger than your windshield, we got a problem. That somehow we need to start standing on the Word of God and dreaming for the impossible. Somehow we need to stand on the Word of God and start praying for miracles, signs, and wonders to follow us. You know, your situation, church, it can change in a second. Man, God proves that time and time again. And if you came in here dreaming today, go back to the drawing board. Because God is a God of miracles. Yes. Success secret number two, use what you have. So number one, start where you're at. Number two, use what you have. So if Shamgar was alive today, him killing 600 people wouldn't have been as hard as it was then, because we got machine guns and tanks and helicopters, right? But Shamgar simply took what he had and decided to dedicate it to service of the Lord. And here's the thing, in this room, like, I'm pretty sure if I went to your garage or whatever, we don't have an ox goad. Does anybody have an ox goad at home? So when I say use what you have, I'm going to give you some things in your life that represent the tool that Shamgar used. Is that cool? And I'm going to fly through these, but what I encourage you to do is circle them, and if they jump off the page at you, go pray through it and say, where can I use this in my life? So here's number one, your first ox goad is your dreams. You might be thinking, man, my dreams, that's really stupid, but it's your dream. You know, like, I used to sit right over here, and I used to, like, have vivid dreams of being on the stage, and I thought it was normal. I thought everybody just dreamed of preaching, you know? But what I realized was that not everybody does that. That was my dream. We got a girl in Northwest Indiana at our campus who has a dream to become a fashion stylist for the Stars. It's, like, really random. But I don't think she could have just came up with that. That's her dream. So if God has given you something that's unique to you, write it down, make it plain, and plan and dream for it, because that is your unique dream. Number two, your enthusiasm. Beethoven was a big-time composer. One time, he composed, like, this crazy song, and he said that when he wrote, God actually spoke through him, and he put it on paper. And one day, a violin player stood up and said, "This is way too hard." Check out Beethoven's response. "When I composed that passage, I was inspired by the Almighty God, the maker of the universe. Do you think I was thinking of your puny little fiddle when God speaks through me?" That's a man who's enthusiastic about what he does. And here's the thing with enthusiasm. It's like faith on fire, and faith on fire is contagious. If you're enthusiastic, follow that. Number three, your talent. I love this line. It's been said that amateurs built Noah's Ark and professionals built the Titanic. You know, also often, we need to understand that we don't need more talent. We need to use what we have. Number four, education. What kind of education you have, MBA, PhD, whatever you got. For me, I got a bachelor's, but more than that, I got a master in the school of hard knocks, boy. Like, you know, I'm ready to go. But here's the thing, whatever your education is, God can use that. Ask God, what do you want me to do with that? Number six, your experience. Ask God, what experience do you want to use in my life? And hear me today, your test, anybody going through a test out there today? Your test can't be your testimony unless you're willing to share it. So, like, what you're going through right now, be willing to share on command, because your story can set somebody else free for what you're going through right now. Experience is not what you know, it's what you do with what you know. Number six, your influence. We all have influence. Check your circle. Jesus, best example ever, spent 3 years with 12 people, changed the world to this day. And only 11 of them made the cut. Number seven, your wisdom. James 1 and 5, I love this. It says, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God and he will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking. How awesome is that? If you need wisdom for a situation, anybody say, I need more wisdom in my life. Yes. Ask for it. Number eight, your creativity. I love Shamgar because he took a stick with a spear on it and went out and saved the nation. And what we always fall into is that we need all the bells and whistles and all this new stuff in order to do what God has called us to do. Also, often we look at what we don't have instead of what's in our pocket. That was way better than you guys responded. And this is, man, it's a huge lesson for us. We're launching into a campus in Blue Island. They're meeting in a gym right now. Here's the thing. Even if we didn't get that new building, God can still move, because what we do with God plus the creativity he's already put inside of us will put us on the right path. Sometimes we focus so much on what we don't have, we forget to use what we do have. So I encourage you guys, do some inventory, go home, check what you already have laying around, what's your ox code in your life. It might just be something that's sitting there. Say, man, I can use this to help some other people. And number nine is your yes. And let me explain this. So number one, start where you are. Number two, use what you have. I'm gonna go into point number three. And the last thing is do what you can. Start where you are, use what you have, do what you can. Yes. You know, like, honestly, sometimes there's, like, so many things in life, like, you feel like you're called to, it's hard to even know where to start. Did anybody ever feel that way? Question, like, can one person really change the world? Can one person in this room really change Chicago? And I kind of feel that way when it comes to recycling. Like, you know, if I take a bottle and put it in here, does it really help, right? And so let me just tell you, break it down, the effect one person can have, and then we're going to wrap up and pray. Is that cool? There was a guy named Edward Kimball. Edward Kimball was a volunteer Sunday school teacher. And one day, somebody walked into his classroom. He was an 18-year-old young man named Dwight Moody. Anybody ever hear of Dwight Moody? And so Dwight Moody walks into his classroom, didn't know Jesus at this time. And during this time, Dwight Moody was a shoe salesman. Edward Kimball went home and he said the Holy Spirit just put on his heart that he needed to share the gospel with Dwight Moody. And so all of a sudden, Edward Kimball goes up to the store where he works. and he was so scared to go do what God told him to do. I know I've been there before. God calls you to do something that just doesn't make sense, right? And he stands up to the door and he's so scared that the devil, we said this before, will try to paint the worst case scenario. This guy's going to think you're crazy because the devil does not want this to happen, right? Yeah. And so finally, he breaks through the fear and taps Dwight L. Moody on the shoulder. And I love this story. Here's what he says. He says, I went up to him, put my hand on his shoulder. And as I leaned over, I made my plea, and I feel that it was a really weak one. I feel that way all the time, right? I don't know just what the words I used. I simply told him of Christ's love for him and the love Christ wanted in return. Now, check this out. Here's Moody's response in a book that he wrote later. Kimball, he said, Moody went on to say, I don't remember what he said, but I can feel the power of that man's hand on my shoulder tonight. Moody goes on to say, it was not long after he came in that I entered the gates of heaven. A volunteer Sunday school teacher led Dwight Moody to the Lord. And through a crazy string of events, I'm going to fly through this, but Dwight Moody went on to become one of the greatest evangelists of all time. He was ministering in a place, and one day there's a man in the room named F.B. Meyer. F.B. Meyer got so infected by what Dwight Moody told in the story that he went on and became an evangelist too. F.B. Meyer then went out, became an evangelist, preached everywhere. Check this out. There was a man named J. Wilbur Chapman that came to one of his meetings. J. Wilbur Chapman went on to find the YMCA. And all of a sudden, like all these people, like because of one man's yes, now all of a sudden hundreds of thousands of people are giving their lives to Christ. But it keeps on getting better. All of a sudden during J. Wilbur Chapman's thing, he steps down. He's got a volunteer named Billy Sunday. Billy Sunday, former baseball player, goes on to be one of the best evangelists and pastors that this world has ever seen. So then Billy Sunday goes out and he does a three-night revival, big time, and invites this great evangelist named Mordecai Ham. Mordecai Ham is preaching the paint off the walls. You guys ever been in a place that's like, oh my gosh. And a 16-year-old was in the room, a tall, lanky young man. And for three nights he came back because he was so moved by the word of God. That man's name was Billy Graham. And that night at the end of that revival service, Billy Graham walked up to that altar and gave his life to Christ because of what a Sunday school teacher did. One man's yes can change your life. You know, you might have walked in here today, you have no idea what to do, but a yes can change your life too. You know, God might be speaking to you to go talk to your neighbor. Your neighbor could be the next Dwight Moody who leads to Billy Graham, who leads to millions of people giving their life to Christ. My challenge for you this week is this, that sometimes your yes makes no sense, but the bigger the yes, the bigger the opportunity for a miracle. Shamgar would have never seen 600-1 odds come to pass if he didn't put himself in a situation to put 600-1 odds come to pass. You know, Taylor and I have been learning this lesson in our life that sometimes our biggest yeses make absolutely no sense. I passed up a big-time job to be a volunteer in a youth ministry, but God has blessed it beyond measure because we said yes. Here's the thing. At the beginning of the year, like we've been praying and praying and praying for a child forever. Pastor Chris prophesied to us, said, become foster parents. And we're like, I have no idea. I don't want to do that. But we said yes. And now we have a little child in our home. Your yes can change the projection of your life. I'm in Northwest Indiana right now because somebody else said no and I said yes. Hear me today. Somebody else had an opportunity before I did, but I stood on the word of God and said, God, if you call me to it, you will bring me through it. And if he did it for me, I just don't understand why he can't do it for you. Because all I knew when we started in youth ministry, I had no education, no training. All I would stand up there and say, I love Jesus, and I know what he did for me. And if he did it for me, he can do it for you too. And if he can do it for you, he can do it for your friend. If he can do it for your friend, he can do it for your neighborhood. If he can do it for your neighborhood, he can do it for your community, in this city, in this nation. If we just say yes. One yes can change your life, church. I'm so sick and tired of people making excuses that they can't do it, not standing on the word of God and stepping through to what he's called us to do. One yes can set you free today. One yes can redefine your direction. One yes can put you in the right place at the right time, in the right situation, and change your situation around. Today is the day I pray that changes history for you. that in the words of whoever wrote Judges, I don't even know. That's how uneducated I am sometimes. That if Shamgar can pick up an ox goat and save a nation, why can't you go apologize to your wife and save your marriage? That if Shamgar can pick up an ox goat, then why can't you minister to your friends and become the next Billy Graham? If Shamgar can do it, I pray that we redefine everything and stand on the word of God. Because if he's called you to it, if you do what only you can do, then God will do what only he can do. Let's pray, church. Father, Lord, I thank you for everything you're doing through us right now. With every head bowed, I'm just praying right now that the Holy Spirit just pricks something in you and dreams come to pass maybe that you had like 50 years ago that you said, man, I'm too old. You're never too old for what God's called you to do. Praying for young people in here right now that say, God has called me to something so big, I don't even know where to start. Praying for divine wisdom today. Right now, Taylor and I, my wife, began praying this prayer like 5 years ago. It's changed our life, and it was simply this: God, whatever you call us to do, we'll go. Nowhere too far, nowhere too short, nothing too big, nothing too small. Whatever you call us to do, we'll say yes. And right now, I'm not even asking you to make a long-term commitment. I'm asking you to make a commitment to God for this week. If God tells you to witness to your neighbor, you go do it. If God tells you to walk out your dream, you go do it. If God tells you to go back to school, you go register tomorrow, on Tuesday, whatever. So if you're willing to do that, I'm just going to ask real quick that you just raise two hands up in the air. I know we all come from different backgrounds, but right now this means just a sign of surrender. So you're saying, man, God, I want your best for my life. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, I just pray for divine opportunity. Father, I ask for wisdom where wisdom's needed, strength where strength is needed, Lord, power where power's needed. Father, I pray that this week, Lord, for divine encounters, Lord, with people that lead to everlasting salvation in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that we see fruit next week. Father, I pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you speak to us in miracles, signs, and wonders, Lord, that whatever we put our hands to be blessed, that whatever we do, Lord, it has your name all over it, so people can't help but give you all the glory. Father, we love you and we lift you up in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. And one more thing, if you guys could just close your eyes and bow your heads, try to make it a rule wherever we preach the gospel that we give somebody an opportunity to respond. So man, the biggest yes you can have today is a yes to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to this world to set you free, and one yes could change your course forever. And if that's you and you say, today's the day, I know that this is a divine appointment. There is no better time. There is no better place. Live in this holy now. If that's you, I'm going to ask that you raise your hand high. And we're just going to pray for you. On the count of three, if that's you, say, today's the day I give my life to Jesus. On the count of three, raise your hand so I can see you. One, two, three. Thank you, I see that hand. Thank you, I see that hand. Hallelujah, I see that hand. Anybody else, thank you, I see that hand. Anybody else, say, today's the day. Thank you, sir, I see that hand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You guys could all repeat this with me. What an opportunity we have to pray with people that today kingdom is yours. Lord Jesus, I know you died for me, and I want to live for you. I surrender everything to you. Take my life and use me. Come into my heart right now. I love you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Bible says when one person comes home, the angels in heaven throw down. Let's give God a big shout of praise this morning, church.